Right. Let me start this wonderful lecture series. I'm Shifu Chen, Dean of Engineering School at Columbia, and really my honor to welcome all of you to our first lecture of this Tech CEO lecture series. And it's particularly so exciting because it's the official launch of this lecture series. And also, it's really incredibly exciting that we have the CEO Benoit Bazin from the company that is so historical, Saint-Gobain, and there's so much relevance to what we do, our mission, and our focus on research, education, innovation. Really a great honor here. And as I mentioned, this is the first lecture of our Tech CEO series. And the idea of the starting this Tech CEO series really for our leaders, this thoughts, deep thinker in the industry who are bringing technology innovation to the practice, to the market, to solve the global challenge, and come back to share with our faculty, our students, their experience, and also their vision, and also their aspirations. So really thank you for visiting us, and thank you for everyone to join here. Also, a little bit of information about this Tech CEO series. This week, we mark the beginning of the NYC Climate Week, right? So it's very busy if you are stuck by traffic in the cross street. You know, it's a very busy week in New York City. And New York City Climate Week is also the largest climate week in the world, right? They have so many events going on. And engineering school this week, we also put together a wonderful set of a program in this area, including there's a thinking water infrastructure, the symposium tomorrow led by Professor Manu Lau, including some of the lectures on climate model, climate prediction using the new advances in artificial intelligence and geophysical modeling. So we have a center called LEAP, LEAP, Learning the Earth with AI and Physics. So there will be a wonderful series of seminars from the centers. So all this will be all this information available on the engineering school website. So please check it out and really explore this wonderful opportunity for this seminar, discussion, and symposium. So let me introduce our exciting, this wonderful guest speaker. And I'd like to also mention after the lecture today and question and answer session, we have a reception in the next building, the Carlton Common. So please join us after this session. Mr. Benoit Bazin, our guest speaker, is really the perfect example of a visionary thinker for our lecture series. And his talk today addressed the critical area of a sustainable building and infrastructures. As we know, the built environment is a significant source of a greenhouse gas emission, and it's driving our need and our effort to create a more sustainable, more green infrastructure in the urban city. I'm really looking forward to hearing his insight today. Mr. Bazin became the CEO of Saint-Gobain in 2021, the company he first joined in 1999. And we all know this is one of the oldest company, respected company in France, in the world. And I think more than 300 years of history, really is wonderful. In Colombia, as you know, we have a history of 260 years. So compared to the company, we are still very young, right? And he has served as a director, member, and chair of Audit and Risk Committee of Essilor. And during 2017, he was a president CEO of CertainTeed Corporation in the United States. And he was appointed the COO of Saint-Gobain in 2019, elected to the board in 2021. He was appointed the director of Vinci in 2020. He's a chairman of the Strategy and CSR Committee and member of the Nomination and Governance Committee. And particularly, he is also the director of the City of Architecture and Heritage Museum in Paris, the largest architectural center in the world. So please welcome Benoit Bazin.
Let me do the video.
Okay, so we'll play a video to introduce the company first.
Bienvenue devant cette tour extraordinaire. Cette tour, c'est pas seulement le siège du groupe, c'est toute la tour qui est un showroom avec nos 80 solutions durables et performantes. Ce sont des solutions pour le neuf et pour la rénovation. Chaque bâtiment doit répondre à un projet de vie tout en préservant l'environnement. C'est fondamental et ce sont ces réflexions qui guident les actions de Saint-Gobain aujourd'hui et demain.
Hoje está em alta aqui, né, no Brasil, a inovação dos sistemas leves. Da fundação, desde da impermeabilização até o telhado da obra, nosso trabalho, né, da Saint-Gobain é justamente mostrar para esses construtores os benefícios que eles podem ter utilizando os nossos produtos. Com a união, então todo mundo começou a falar a mesma língua, né? Então o cliente conversa com uma pessoa apenas. Isso é bastante orgulhoso de passar, por exemplo, na frente de um prédio e ver que ali utilizou-se produtos que está gerando coisas boas, né, para quem está morando ali.
Kimya aslında birçok şeyin temel noktası. Yaptığımız yüksek performanslı, çevre dostu, kullanıcı dostu kimyasal katkı malzemelerimiz var. Bunlarla betonun performansını arttırmaya çalışıyoruz. Betonun performansını arttırırken de aslında betonda kullanılan su ihtiyacını azaltıyoruz. Veya katkıda bulunduğumuz projelerin uzun süre yaşamasını istiyoruz, hedefliyoruz. Yeni belki yapıları yapıyor olmak bence bizler için çok güzel. Bu sorumluluğu taşımak da hoşuma gidiyor. Bunun içerisinde olmayı da seviyorum.
Den här modellen var vi helt först med. Kunderna kan komma in när som helst under hela året, hela dygnet. De går in med en app och de handlar själva. Den här typen av obemannade butiker gör att vi kan öppna upp på fler ställen där vi kommer närmare kund.
Digitalisering är så mycket, mycket mer än bara en bra e-shop. Så har vi massor av värdefull data. Data som vi kan analysera för att förbättra våra rutiner och processer, likväl som hela tiden kunna utveckla vårt kunderbjudande.
Open innovation is really it's a great topic for us at Saint-Gobain. We practice that with architects, with installers, with customers, with homeowners. We want to find partners that have the same mindset, the same values. If I take the example of Hyperframe, it's a mixed reality wall framing solution that enables extreme productivity. So we're talking about 10 times faster job installation while also minimizing waste. What we want to solve is this sustainability challenge, listening every different voices. It's exciting, it's exhilarating, you know.
Qui per TGV Via Velia Horizont noi sviluppiamo il parabrezza, il faro destro e sinistro e il top light. Basti pensare che si proponeva questo progetto dei target con una riduzione di peso del 20%, un aumento della capacità dei passeggeri del 20%, un tasso di riciclabilità del 97%. Con orgoglio abbiamo accettato questa sfida. Il parabrezza è stato, nonostante la riduzione di peso richiesta, ha superato i test omologativi per un impatto a 512 km/h. Quindi è stato davvero stimolante, anche se a volte non semplice.
Mirror operation rathu idhukku munnadi la vandu men vachu da run panna mudiyum or operations appdi nenikiranga but women aliyum panna mudiyum 100% women employee vachi ennoda mukkiyamaana pangu indha mirror line la enna na 100% women employee maathanunrathu engaloda mukkiyamaana initiative ah naanga eduthu vandirukom ellarume pudhu people new kind of atmosphere we are bringing in
நாங்க சஸ்டைனபிலிட்டி மெஷர்ஸ் நிறைய எடுத்திருக்கோம். அதுல முக்கியமான விஷயம் என்னன்னா ரிசோர்ஸ் கன்சர்வேஷன், எனர்ஜி கன்சர்வேஷன், பயோடைவர்சிட்டி அண்ட் CO2 எமிஷன். இதன் மூலியமா இந்த சஸ்டைனபிலிட்டி ப்ராடக்ட்ஸ் எங்களால் ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ண முடியுது. அதனால எங்களோட விஷனான மேக்கிங் த வேர்ல்ட் அ பெட்டர் ஹோம் அதை சாத்தியமா கொண்டு வர முடியுது.
Tout le monde est en marche avec un même objectif. Depuis l'imagination du produit jusqu'à la fin, tout a été bien tracé, suivi. Alors oui, on est fiers d'être dans cette société. Ce n'est pas des mots, ce sont des actes. Et c'est à nous d'apporter tous les éléments, à la fois de confort et de performance, et de protection de l'environnement.
I'm very good afternoon, everyone. I'm very honored to be with all of you. Thank you for the kind words of introduction. We are at a crossroad on many topics. So it's very important for you, the new generation, to look at all the things we can do and how you can contribute. Because we all know that on many important topics, we have an urgent call for actions. And this is what I would like to share with you on what Saint-Gobain is doing, where we are operating. And after that, of course, take your questions, reaction, challenges, because it's very important, I think, to inspire each other. When you think of the planet, there are three challenges where we wanted to operate, where we wanted to bring the know-how and the expertise of Saint-Gobain. Three challenges: one around CO2 emissions. The built environment make 37, close to 40% of the CO2 emissions of the planet. So any country that is committed towards carbon neutrality cannot do it without tackling seriously the built environment, the construction sector overall, the lifetime of the building. Second, natural resources preservation. We know that we cannot do things in the future like we have done in the past. And third, we have a growing population. In many cities of developing countries, we will have 2 billion population in the next 3 decades. So we need to build differently, better and faster. So those are the three main challenges where the construction activity, the construction sector is, you know, fronting and where we need to provide solutions. So this is what we have decided to put at the core of the strategy of Saint-Gobain. I will first illustrate what it means and what are the solutions, and second, what we are doing at Saint-Gobain on those three big challenges. First, coming back to the CO2 emissions, indeed it's, you know, 40% coming from construction. It's roughly 30% during the extraction of the raw materials, the manufacturing of building materials, the erection of the buildings, and 70% during the lifetime of the building in terms of energy efficiency, in terms of air conditioning, in terms of how you dismantle the building at the end. So that's extremely important to tackle. There is not a single sector where you have such a big topic. And to some extent, the construction, the built environment, is the crossroad of three important transitions. The climate, we'll come back to it. The energy transition, you know, in Europe, elsewhere around the world, people go to war for energy. There is one sector, the building sector, where you can save energy. And the best energy is the one you don't spend. You cannot do that in transport. You cannot drive an electrical vehicle without electricity. You cannot make a lot of materials without energy. In buildings, you can drop energy down almost to zero. So the construction sector is at the crossroad of the climate change, 40% of the CO2 emissions, also the energy crisis and transition, and third, the social topic, because you have a lot of areas, including in New York City, including in Paris, where people had to decide whether to buy food or whether to buy or pay for the heating system in the cold winter. So that's the task of the construction sector on climate change, on energy, on social issues. And we know how to do it. The technical solutions do exist. The second is natural resources. And here you call for circular economy. You know, if you think of centuries ago, we used to build just by reusing former materials. The Greeks, they took some of the stones from the Egyptian temples, except that in the last 100 years, we built with new materials. But circular economy is getting there in the construction sector and can be very significant. And the third, of course, is to provide, you know, the dwellings and the construction in all the emerging markets where you have to build for these 2 billion of new inhabitants in the big cities. So urban planning, some of you are in urban planning, of course, good buildings, better buildings from day one. So those are the three main challenges that we face within the construction sector. So we at Saint-Gobain, we decided to put that at the core of our strategy, aligned with our purpose, you heard it, making the world a better home. And we are pushing solutions to tackle those three challenges. First, 5 years ago, we reorganized the company. We used to be organized by product lines, but if you sell just a piece of glass, a piece of wallboard, a piece of insulation, a piece of flooring systems, you are not going to provide the end solution. You are not going to change the system. So we decided to reorganize the group by country so that the country CEO could have all the building materials to provide a solution for a facade, to provide an acoustic performance for a classroom. So we have reorganized the group deeply. So when you turn a 357 years old company that used to be by product line into a country organization, it's a massive shift in terms of organizational change. We did it before the COVID, and we have the richness within Saint-Gobain to have 90% of our country CEOs that are native from their country. So it's a Vietnamese manager in Vietnam, it's a Polish lady in Poland, it's a Brazilian CEO in Brazil, etc., etc. It gives a lot of power to service the local markets with local manufacturing plants. We have 800 of them around the world. The products don't travel, so it makes perfect sense. So first, a reorganization of the group to truly tackle not only product by product, but as a system, what's needed in order to overcome the barriers of CO2, of natural resource, etc., country by country, which makes it very, very powerful. You can come back to that in your questions. After that, on CO2 emissions, there are two main topics. First, it's energy efficiency and retrofit of existing buildings. If you take a lot of countries around the world, we know that 85 to 90% of the buildings that will be there in 2050, they are there today. So you have to retrofit them. And when you do it right, with the right building envelope, the retrofit of energy efficiency renovation, you can divide by 5-6 times the energy spent in this building. We do it for single family home renovation in France. We divide by 70% the energy bill and therefore the CO2 emissions. So energy efficiency is a big, big topic where we tackle all the different solutions of Saint-Gobain. It could be up to 30 products differently, but truly tackling energy and CO2 emissions within buildings, public and private. It's also very important to be exemplary on the public buildings. The second, and it's more towards new build, new construction, is what we call light construction. Light construction is when you move away from a wall of traditional bricks and concrete blocks, and you put the load-bearing elements on pillar. It could be a timber frame, it could be steel, you could move towards low-carbon steel, it could be low-carbon concrete pillars. And when you do that, you save at least 50% of the weight of the materials and therefore the CO2. So for new construction, moving away from traditional methods of a full wall of cement and concrete towards load-bearing on pillars, you save a lot of resources and weight and therefore embodied CO2. So we are also promoting in many, many countries light construction systems, up to the point where I thought it was relevant to hire an architect at the board of Saint-Gobain. So it's very unusual. Usually you have other corporate CEOs, different boards, but we have an architect at the board of Saint-Gobain, and she launched 16 years ago the Global Sustainability Award for Architecture. So it's very important to be challenged as a CEO by her at the board in terms of what is sustainable architecture going forward. So that's for light construction. The third thing is circular economy. We are doing a lot of that on recycling materials into our processes. And I will illustrate now how we run the company. So that's the three challenges: CO2, energy efficiency renovation, natural resource preservation, light construction, and circular economy that we have put together at the core of the strategy of Saint-Gobain, aligned with our purpose, making the world a better home. Now, the strategic plan, we have to roll out this strategy on worldwide leadership in light and sustainable construction. We call it Grow and Impact. We try to measure the impact of our solutions, 70% drop of the energy bill, what it means in other sectors. And of course, the bigger the impact, the higher the growth we will get, because the customers and homeowners are going to ask for our solutions. And the faster we grow, the more we'll scale up and speed up the rollout of our solution. So this is the snowball effect, Grow and Impact, that we have launched 3 years ago in order to roll out our strategy and deliver on our purpose. So we want to maximize the impact of our solutions in buildings, and we want to minimize, of course, our carbon footprint. A few examples on how we maximize our solutions. We have launched a year ago the first ever low carbon glass. We had a run of zero carbon production of flat glass in France. And after that, we launched a low carbon glass offer, minus 40% of CO2 in glass by using a lot more recycled glass, biogas, changing some parameters on the process. And we have the first low carbon glass offer. We have also started the first worldwide plasterboard, wallboard plant in Norway with zero carbon production. We do that because we have hydropower electricity in Norway. The second will be in Canada, in Quebec, with hydropower, and we have a low carbon wallboard offer on the market. So that's the kind of low carbon offer. We also measure the impact of our solutions. I take a very different example on schools. We measure, and we can measure, that there is a correlation between the acoustic of the classroom and the absenteeism of teachers. So if you are a good school director, good citizen for the planet, you would work on the thermal efficiency of your school so that you save on the energy bill, you save on the CO2, you invest the savings of the energy bill in computers or tools for the children, for the teachers. But on top of that, if you have a good acoustic renovation, you improve the working environment of the teachers. After 15 years in a ceramic tile type of classroom, you know, you have blood pressure, you have absenteeism. If you have the right acoustic environment, the teacher will be, you know, in good condition, and the children will learn also better. So you can measure all that, for instance, acoustic correlation with good quality of teaching and learning. So these are all kinds of solutions that we measure in terms of impact, because it's very important in our construction sector to measure the impact and document the before and after so that you convince the public bodies, the regulators on what is right on energy efficiency, what is right in terms of acoustic of a classroom, et cetera, et cetera. And then we try also to work and continue to accelerate on minimizing our footprint. We took the commitment 4 years ago at the UN to be carbon neutral by 2050. So you could say it's very far away. Benoit will not be there, doesn't care about 2050. Actually, in our industry, it's a very long-term capital planning. You know, a float line for flat glass does last 20 years. After 20 years, you have to rebuild the furnace, and we have lines that have been there for 150 years because you rebuild every 20 years. So that means we need by 2030 to know and to build a plan that will be carbon neutral by 2050. And 2030 on a flat glass line, which is $150 million of capital expenditure, you don't do it overnight. That means we need a pilot by 2025. And that means our researchers, our process engineers are already working on it. So 2050 for a large manufacturing with long cycles of investment, it's not too far away. It's almost tomorrow morning. And one example on that, we have made a world premiere in Germany last May to run hydrogen in a glass furnace, which is quite tricky in terms of environment, in terms of water in the furnace, in terms of all the conditions that you need to change on the glass furnace. So a lot of initiatives to minimize the footprint of Saint-Gobain. Over the last 5 years, we dropped by 27% the total emissions of CO2, scope 1 and 2 of the group. We grew the total turnover, so the carbon intensity in 1 euro of turnover has dropped by 42%. I think it's important to have that in mind because that means you can grow, this is our plan, grow and impact while still dropping your CO2 emissions, because we need to provide the solutions for better environment, better built environment across the world. But we have, of course, to minimize our footprint, and we did it over the last 6 years. One tool that we used to do that is that we imposed to ourselves an internal carbon price since 2016. You know, in Europe, we have a carbon tax, a market for that carbon tax, but it doesn't exist in the US, doesn't exist in Brazil or in China or in India. For us, within Saint-Gobain, around the world, in the 76 countries, there is not a single CapEx, so investment in a plant, acquisition, R&D project, where we don't compute the internal carbon tax. It's 100 euros, so above the market price for capital expenditures, and it's 200 euros for the R&D project, which are a bit further away because we think the carbon price will continue to increase. So we have all those tools to make sure that we drive our efforts, our roadmap to minimize the carbon footprint of Saint-Gobain. So many examples, I could go on with a lot of other examples. One, of course, is to continue to work on circular economy. I take our glass wool insulation products that you put on partitions, on roof. In Europe, it's 70%, 70% recycled materials. We have launched also a plasterboard with 50% recycled materials. So there are a lot of things you can do on circular economy to drop the CO2 content of your products and minimize your footprint. So this is the, I would say, the positive, virtuous circle of maximizing the solutions for the homeowners, the buildings, public, private, the end customers, and of course, minimizing our footprint. That's the strategy of Saint-Gobain, putting those three challenges, CO2 emissions, natural resource preservation, 2 billion population where we need to build. That's the three challenges we want to tackle, where we have a duty to put our expertise at work, our know-how at work. And this is how we do it, maximizing, minimizing this kind of dynamic. For that, and it's, I think it's interesting for you as students, we have a lot of innovation. We spent almost $600 million of R&D around the world every year. We do it with corporate centers of R&D. We have some of them, six of them around the world, if I simplify, three in the main developed markets, US, France, and Germany, and three in the developing markets, Brazil, India, China. So we are local and close to our end market so that we capture the benefits and the needs also, because you don't build in Vietnam like you build in Canada, and it's very important to be close to our market. So we invest a lot on innovation, and I conclude there. It's a fascinating time today. On one side, you have the urgency of tackling the challenges, and we cannot say we don't know. We cannot say the built environment is insignificant versus other sectors. It's one of the largest, and we have the solution. We have the technical solution. So it's fascinating to work there and to make sure that we have this positive impact on the planet. It's fascinating because there are a lot of things which are changing, a lot of new materials. When you recycle different materials, when you take the demolition waste, by law in France, we have to take the demolition waste on any job site and put it back in our manufacturing processes. So you sort out the PVC, the aluminium, the glass, the gypsum, the glass wool, in order to bring it back as input of raw materials in your manufacturing processes. But you have to adjust and fine tune all the parameters. So it's fascinating. Sometimes you have the impression to be at the head of a large startup, but with the means and the resources of a large corporation to invest on all those priorities. So a lot of things are going on. We have plenty of opportunities. I started as an intern even before 99 for 1 year. So we take internship, we take PhDs. We have a lot of cooperation with many, many universities around the world. You have many, many ways to develop a career within Saint-Gobain, to start as a researcher, to move during your R&D project on the manufacturing job site. So you confront the lab reality with the manufacturing reality, a true manufacturing line, and after that to move to a business or product management or sales experience around the world. So many, many opportunities, because we need the brain, we need the passion, we need the energy of the next generation to embrace those challenges, which again will make the world a better home, make a better planet, and also bring a lot to the well-being of the population, the homeowners at home, the schools, the hospitals, the built environment, you know, universities, a lot of places around the world. We can bring a lot in terms of well-being. So that's a bit around Saint-Gobain, the built environment, and what we can bring with the energy, the brains, the passion of everyone towards such an important topic. I stop there, and I'm sure you have many questions, and it could be on Saint-Gobain, it could be on buildings, it could be on leadership, how you run a company. I'm here with my colleagues, Mark Refield, with our CEO for North America, and Hardy, who is the Chief Innovation Officer at Saint-Gobain, Todd Dinoya, who is our Innovation Head also for North America. To tell you also that the Executive Committee, we have 8 nationalities within Saint-Gobain, so we are quite diverse in terms of background, culture, nationalities, and that's the richness of what we can bring to the planet and to our end customers. Who wants to start, please? Yeah.
Hello, my name is Anna. I'm a doctorate student in Europe, actually, but I'm here for the Climate Week. I have a question. Thank you so much for the presentation.
Could you bring the mic a bit closer?
Thank you so much for the presentation. I'm just curious because I see that in Europe right now with the next generation funds, there's a lot being channeled precisely to impulse the building retrofit sector, right? However, it seems that there's a difficulty in the demand. I'm an urban policy student, so I also think about how do you see this developing, at least in Europe, and perhaps there's a parallel in America, in terms of how the demand of making a retrofit, even if subsidies are there, there appears to be some sort of resistance from homeowners. How do you see this panorama of the demand side?
It's a very good question, because to some extent in the built environment, the breakthrough innovation is not so much on the technical solution. You know, if you ask us to make a passive house, a house that will generate more electricity than what it takes, whether it's in Manchester, in Minneapolis, or in Sao Paulo, we know how to do it. The breakthrough innovation for us is to have this very fragmented, sometimes conservative value chain moving. The homeowner who said, you know, I don't need it, I cannot afford it. The architect who is scared to death to go to something different. The mayor that doesn't want to deliver the permit. The banks that don't care about whether they finance a good home or a bad home in terms of, so the challenge is to move this value chain from craftsmen to architects to bankers, etc. And it's not easy. There are regulations, frankly speaking. I think the best is to define regulations well ahead so that you don't take people by surprise. And the EU is calling for tripling the renovation rate. And one good mechanism that has been developed and already implemented in France is to say, you measure the energy performance on any building, public or private. And we measure it now in France from A to G, and that's coming in other countries, and telling 5 years, 8 years ahead, if you are G, by 2025, you cannot rent your place anymore. If you are F, by 2028, and so on and so forth. So that's what we have in place in France. It's a bit like you would not rent, you know, I remember when I was at MIT as a student, I rented something with lead painting. I should not have done it, but okay, you would not rent anymore a place with lead painting, with asbestos, with all kinds of bad products. So to some extent, you know, energy performance is a must. So in any transaction in France now, whether you rent, whether you sell or buy, you have the energy performance diagnosis. Plus, you have the list of what has to be done in order to go from G to C or from F to B, et cetera, et cetera. So that's already very good that you have a regulation, that you have a framework where it's well-defined and you know how to go. After that, the difficulty is sometimes it could be expensive. And if you take the F and G, I will give you the example of France to illustrate. It's roughly 17% of all the dwellings, so it's not insignificant. It's very often low-income people, either homeowner or people who rent the place. If they rent, that means the energy bill is very expensive, so they have to decide whether to buy food or pay the energy bill, so you have to help them. And you need a public support. So we have subsidies in France. I asked and I called for what I call the Marshall Plan to help on retrofit in France, and basically directing the support towards the F&G, because it's low-income people. The out-of-pocket money has to be less significant. If it's 90%, they are not going to do it. If it's 20-30%, they are going to do it. So direct the public support there, help them because it's low-income people. If you don't do it, all those dwellings are going outside of the rent market in 5 years, so it's going to deepen the housing crisis you have in your country. And third, even if you take just a CO2 approach, they make 70%, 70, the energy slum makes 70% of the CO2 emission. So for all those good reasons, you need to direct the public support towards those F&G type of dwelling. So I think the good approach is to have a framework to say, this is a good or not so good building, public or private. This is the requirement in order to get there in the right order. This is the timeline, you have to do it. And after that, if I take the payback, in France or in Europe, the energy is much more expensive than in the US, 4 to 5 times. What used to be a 10 years payback on an energy efficiency renovation in Europe now is 3 to 4 years. So in 3 or 4 years, because it's roughly €250 per square meter, so $250 for 10 square feet, it's not massive, and you have a 3 to 4 years payback just on the energy bill. On top of that, you increase your real estate value if you do it right. So I would say the economic rationale is getting there with a bit of support from public money, which makes sense because everywhere you have to have a fair transition. It's like you cannot ask people to drop their car and everyone buy a Tesla. You have to have a fair transition, notably for the low-income people, otherwise you are going to create a lot of social unrest. And individuals are not going to care about the CO2 emission of their individual home. They are going to care about whether I dropped my energy bill and whether I have a better thermal comfort. So you need to have all those rationale in place. But it's possible. That's good news. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Khalid. I'm from Saudi Arabia and I'm a freshman here. So my question is, so I think you mentioned that 30% of carbon footprints comes from constructing the buildings. So my question is, how can we utilize, or what are your thoughts of using 3D printing technologies to construct mega projects? And when do you think we can reach that goal?
But first, I'm happy because, when we look at the development of Saint-Gobain, we look at the big countries in terms of population. Because for us, population is a big driver of construction and housing. And Saudi Arabia is one of our priority, like Indonesia, like the big Egypt, countries in terms of population. So frankly speaking, 3D printing, we have worked on it. We know how to do it, not only for construction, but sometimes it could be prototyping, some ceramics, special mark, products. It's very good when you have a customized need, when you have a very short series. Otherwise, the manufacturing scale of 100 million square meters of plasterboard or glass is much, much more cost efficient than 3D printing. So if you ask, yes, a very special design for, some concrete elements or stairs or on a very small run, 3D printing is available. We do it. We do it in the Netherlands. We do it in Southeast Asia. We do it in Czech Republic. But it's not something which is going to solve the affordability or the speed and the scale that you need in construction. But yes, for special design.
Thank you.
Maybe a question in the back, yeah?
Hello, my name is Harry Kubota. I'm from Uganda, and I'm a master's student here with a concentration in computational and data-driven engineering mechanics. Thank you so much for your presentation. As a leader of a multinational corporation, how do you balance innovation with risk? Because with innovation comes, you know, better methods to solve the problems we have, but there's also risks in taking such leaps. Thank you.
It would be interesting to share the answer with Anardi. We have first define what are the four priorities for us on R&D. So it's decarbonizing our processes, systems for light construction, circular economy, and new applications for new materials. So first, I think it's very important to prioritize versus go too far from what is the core of your business and your know-how. After that, we have well-defined processes. We used to be in the past, if I look at Saint-Gobain, you know, years ago, we used to be very sequential in our innovation process. R&D, and then R&D would give it to product management, and product management would give it to manufacturing, and manufacturing would be give it to sales. And sometimes, oh, there is no sale anymore because the product has changed or it's not the customer requirement. So now we have a much more horizontal approach, a team approach, loop, you know, to circle back and change, fine-tune. We have also processes, what we call stage gate, to define the go, no-go. So we try to de-risk the innovation process. But maybe, Anne, you would like to elaborate also on how you see it.
Sure. I'll try not to take the rest of the time on this topic because it's actually a critical topic when you look at innovation. And so it's something we talk about a lot. And so I'm going to just say a few things about this, and I'm happy to maybe take a discussion afterwards on this. And so one is that we, like many companies, look at the horizon. I don't know if this is a framework that you know, but we say, is this core to our business? Is this something that we could expand adjacent to what we're doing? Or is this something that's going to be breakthrough and disruptive? And so we look at what we're trying to do and we divide our portfolios. So Todd looks at the portfolio and says, let's make sure that we have things that support what we're doing today, because that's how we're going to be making money for today. But at the same time, we need to be thinking about what's happening in the world and what's going to disrupt us. What can we do that's really going to be breakthrough? And we need to make sure that we have that we're funding those kind of ideas as well. So that's it's one framework that you can put this into. I want to emphasize something that Benoit said. And so one of the things that we have really, really been pushing is the idea that innovation doesn't just come from R&D. Innovation requires a whole value chain of people to be involved. It needs supply chain, it needs manufacturing, it needs the salespeople. And if you just put it in the corner, let R&D work on it first, and then R&D raises their hand and says, we've been working on this for 5 years, we have something for you. And the business says, oh, someone launched something 3 years ago or whatever it is. It's really important to be really very well connected across this. And so this idea of a learning loop, but adapted from agile kind of things that people do in software development, but how does that work then in a manufacturing company? There are ways to embrace that. I could take the rest of the time to talk about this topic. I will give more time to Benoit to answer, but would be happy to talk with people afterwards.
Yes, one question over there. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Alexandre Ancelotti, a French student pursuing a PhD in electrical engineering here. So my question is, most buildings currently nowadays are built from concrete. And I wanted to know how sustainable is concrete, especially regarding recycling, and what are your innovations, policies or actions within the company to innovate regarding new building materials for very big buildings like skyscrapers here?
So it's indeed a very important question, because concrete generate a lot of CO2 emissions. If you take cement and concrete, it's 6% roughly of the world's CO2 emissions. We don't make cement, we don't make concrete, but several answers to that. First, if you move to light construction, you can save a lot of concrete. If you take buildings, again, a skyscraper in the US would be steel frame, would be concrete pillars, but not a full wall of concrete blocks. That's one, and it's important. Second, you would still need concrete for infrastructure, tunnels, bridges, and there you can go with very low carbon concrete. by substituting cement and the clinker in cement with other materials less carbonated. And for that, we have a business within Saint-Gobain. We invested on what we call construction chemical. It's additives, admixtures, polymers, and sometimes you put just 1-2% in concrete, but it will help substitute the carbonated materials within the concrete, because you would substitute clinker with slag, with fly ash, with other materials not carbonated, and keep the end properties of concrete that you need: mechanical resistance, rheology, whatever, workability on the job site. So you keep the same end properties, but you have substituted the carbonated materials in it. And the third, which is growing, is circular economy, because you can take the demolition waste, grind it, sort it with the aggregate, the sand we take back. I was in Spain last week, and we take back some sand from demolition and grinding processes of concrete. So there are some answers. If you take, in Paris, we have this big Paris Express, which was supposed to be ready for the Olympics next summer. Sorry, you will still have to take the old trains to get to the Olympic stadiums. But there are a lot of tunnels and infrastructure work. Vinci, I'm at the board of Vinci, they took the commitment to have 90% by 2030 ultra low carbon concrete. And they have already tested that in this Paris Grand Express big infrastructure tunnels. So, heavy infrastructure where they substituted with new concrete. And within admixtures, we have even done a clay, concrete with clay, no cement at all, just clay. So you have also a lot of innovation towards concrete. Like in glass, we never thought within glass, to substitute calcium carbonate. I don't know if you're an expert of wollastonite. I was not, even though I did some engineering study. I did not know wollastonite. Now in India, we run some glass runs with wollastonite, and we substitute naturally carbonated materials. So you have your scope one because of the materials and the reaction of the materials with wollastonite, where there is no carbon. And we save 3-4% just on that in India. So you have a lot of innovation. Another example, it's not related to concrete, but our latest gypsum wallboard plant in India, it's in a rice agriculture environment. We take the rice husk, we make briquettes, and 100% of the plant energy is with rice husk. So that biomass. And of course, if you don't have any rice, you will do something elsewhere. But so what is fascinating, as I said, if you allow the creativity of the teams on the ground, because they know better than me, and if you empower them, then you take rice biomass in India, you take something else elsewhere, you try wollastonite, and there are a lot of solutions. It's not a one size fits all, but if you are well organized, then you create a lot of new applications, new solutions. There was one question. Yeah.
Good evening, Ms. Benoit. Thank you for having this session with us. My question might be more addressed to North American executives. So there are a lot of students who is potentially looking for opportunities, internships. So in the website, there are two internship opportunities present, one for IT and second for marketing intern for US. So could you just maybe share with us what could be opportunities for engineers and others? What are the typical cycles? What is a typical track for graduate students? And how do you guys source the guys from universities?
I will let Mark answer. I can tell you there is much more than that, because we invested $6 billion in North America in the last 4 years. To give you the shift of the group, we changed 1/3 of the perimeter of the group. And now North America makes 30% of our profit. Emerging markets, 32% in Asia, Latin America, and 38% Western Europe. So I always beat Mark to say, hey, you have not enough engineers, not enough researchers. So Mark, you can hire half of the room. So pay attention.
So I'm in trouble again. So I think it's a little off cycle on interns, probably why there's only two there. We probably had over 150 interns through North America last year, just across all of the businesses and in every areas, whether it be engineering, marketing, finance. I'll let Todd talk about the engineering, the R&D track going forward. So we're always looking for vast numbers of diverse interns at all levels of their educational scope to come in to learn from our business and to grow in our business, hopefully to fall in love with our business and come back after you graduate and work in our business. So we can connect with somebody to let you know where to send your resume and where to connect on that. And I'll let Todd talk about the R&D side. But we've always had interns, but probably 3 years ago, we started doubling and doubling again the numbers that we bring in. And they've been a fantastic asset to our business. And as Benoit said, making the world a better home, being focused on sustainability really resonates with the generation of interns coming in now that want to have an impact on the built environment and how we can decarbonize construction. So it's a great place, and we're dying for more people. So I promise you, there's more than two.
And the interesting thing is that it's across many, many fields. You know, we have architects in our teams, we have biologists, physical scientists, we have chemists, we have sociologists, because when you deal with the built environment, you have to understand the sociology. So it's mathematics, you know, digital, applied science. So we have a lot of different fields.
So at our research center outside of Boston, we have one of the research centers Benoit mentioned. It's about 350 on site. We host a very nice summer internship program. We had about 35 students this year, bachelor's, master's, about 12 on the PhD level, from all types of disciplines, from environmental health and safety to engineering to material sciences. It's not only an internship program to get applied research work, it's also to learn. We have a curriculum where we actually teach the students a number of things of working in an applied environment, doing statistics, doing design of experiments, how to write a technical report. And so there's an educational component to it as well. We launch it every year. It's nationwide. We have students from the South, the West Coast, around the area come to our center for the summertime. And we do this at other centers too. So we have about a dozen outside of this large center across the US as well. And applications do go out in the March timeframe, February timeframe. So if you're interested, just look online. You should be able to apply. Yeah. Actually, January, they go out. So early.
Okay. There was one question here. You.
Hi. That was loud. My name is Adrian, and I'm a first year undergrad. And my question kind of has to do with the company's switch to sustainable products. I imagine that Saint-Gobain hasn't always been focusing on sustainable products. So I'm wondering, first off, how long did that pivot take? And what were some of the biggest challenges associated with that pivot and some of the most surprising challenges as well? And if it was different depending on countries and all that, just like the process of pivoting.
Thank you, because it's an important question and a broad one. We have always been on the built environment. We started 25 years ago to take care of the thermal efficiency regulation, but without thinking as of today about the CO2 impact, the planet impact, because frankly, the topic was not there or was not perceived as so urgent. My predecessor took a very strong stance in the early 2010 to say, this is our drive, up to the point where we generalized this CO2 internal cost in 2016. And so far we are one of the few corporations around the world to do it across all countries. Took the UN commitment in 2019. So it started early on in terms of, okay, we are on double glazing, we are on glass wool insulation. So it's our topic to take care of the building envelope. But without realizing that, it was more energy efficiency than the impact on the planet. Sand, if I take sand, we thought even 10 years ago that sand would be available for forever. It's not the case anymore. So things are accelerating, unfortunately, very, very fast. So after that, the positive surprise is that once you define such a clear alignment between the purpose, the vision, light and sustainable construction, the plan, grow and impact, I've not, in my 30 years of professional experience, I've never seen a topic where it is so easy to engage and align everyone. You know, if you take cash, a totally different topic, finance people would say, hey, I need cash, because I need to be safe on the balance sheet. But engineers would say, I need more capex in my plant. Researchers would say, hey, I need, and M&A people would say, I need to make an acquisition. So cash, you have to trade off. On sustainability, I can tell you it's 168,000 employees of Saint-Gobain driving towards the same goal. So it's a fantastic, and for me, 10 times more than what I thought, alignment and energy that you get from all generations. No, it's not only the young generations, it's everyone all around the world. I mentioned the example of biomass in the US. You could say energy is cheaper. Well, okay, but for instance, in the US, it's cheaper to landfill the product than recycle it. Okay, we'll recycle it. So it's because we have decided to do so. So the alignment of the team has been extremely positive and supportive. So big surprise. The negative is that if I take the what I have sometimes above my head in terms of investors, you could think 5 years ago, 4 years ago, that the financial community would drive ESG in the right direction. I'm afraid to say that, at least in the US, they don't care anymore. You have read the stories of the big investment funds, sorry, if the teachers in Texas ask me to invest in oil, I invest in oil. If the Texas, the Californian teachers ask me to invest, I do it. So the financial community is more divided than it used to be 5 years ago on this topic. So we do it because we think it's right for the planet, right for the customers, right for our teams, and it will make Saint-Gobain a better company. Because when you are better on your energy consumption, you are better on your CO2 emissions. If you reduce your waste, you are better, etc. So we do it, we drive it, but the financial community is less supportive. So that's a negative than what it was 5 years ago. And then the regulation is very, very complex. You have taxonomy in Europe, you have a different system in the US. So there is not a clear framework where everyone would have the same level playing field. But so that's a bit of the positive and negative. But I can tell you, for me, we don't look backward, we look forward. And we have many, many examples where we do win business because we are more sustainable. Because we take back, if you ask Columbia University to revamp the buildings, we are the only one to take back all the glass in our furnace versus a competitor. If we are the only one to do it, we win. If you cannot provide that solution, you lose. So all this is a very positive drive, including on the business side. I think you had one question here. Who has the mic? Okay, and then the lady over there.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Tat Chan. I am a Columbia alum. I had a question regarding the vast conglomeration of products that are produced by your company. And as you had mentioned, Tesla, right? My understanding is that Tesla's ambition or their strategy had been to build products that a small amount of people could afford and then continue to build products that a small number of people could afford and then continue to scale to a larger production size and then finally a massive production size, which everyone can afford. Are there any parallels to such products that you would find within your company that you find most most excited about?
Well, we have one good example is Sage. It's a glass which is electrochromic, so it goes from transparent to dark by switching the electrical current in it, and in a matter of minutes it goes from dark to transparent. So it's very good to save on air conditioning. If you have the sun in your face, for instance, we did all the headquarters of Google in India with our Sage glass. But it's a bit high end. You have to wire it. It's a lot of automation to connect with the drive of the system in terms of building. So that's something we would be happy to bring to a larger scale type of application in the future. But we have to drop the cost. We have to make it available for more people. So far, it's more for headquarters, corporates, high-end hotels than for general building. But that's one example of a new innovative product that hopefully we can scale and launch in a broader spectrum of customers.
Hello, my name is Lassa. I'm an engineering student from France as well. I was curious how it is to manage a global company that is a manufacturing company, because I assume every CEO, every regional CEO, faces different governments, different demands, different priorities. So what does a global meeting look like, and how do you combine all those requirements?
I try. It's an interesting topic. First, if I describe the full organization, so we are by country. We have known each other quite a while. I've been 25 years around. I was working with Mark 20 years ago in the US, so we know each other well. So I think experience matters, knowing the people matters. Within Saint-Gobain, we have a lot of internal mobility. Yes, we are happy to take new people from outside. When we make an acquisition, we are happy to take the teams and grow them. But we have also a lot of internal mobility. So that's good because you know each other. We know who is the best Polish manager, the best manager for Germany, et cetera, et cetera. So that helps, knowing each other with a long-term commitment. We have a long history. We have a long vision and a long experience of the different teams. But that's the country CEOs. Of course, lead by example. When you pick the CEOs yourself, you need to lead by example to set the tone at the top of the country, at the top of the corporation in terms of drive, in terms of energy, in terms of prioritization, etc. On top of that, the group, to make sure that we scale and we benefit from the experience of the group, we have three main functions, which is the glue of the group and the different countries. We have one on innovation with Anne, so that if there is a good idea in Canada, let's put it in the US or from Mexico to Brazil. We have a second one, which is on industry performance, where we have experts by processes. They don't run the plants, because all the plants in North America report to Mark, or in Germany report to the German CEO, but we benchmark every month the 66 plasterboard plants around the world on yield, line speed, waste, energy management, etc. So if you are a plant manager in the middle of Romania, you can say, oh, I'm top 10 in waste management, but I'm at the bottom on productivity. How could I learn from others? So that's the second group. And the third is digital and IT. So we have bricks, platforms, and we can scale up digital and IT. We have 1,500 developers in India. So those are the three very important elements on innovation, industry performance by process, defining the large capex, and digital, so that we benefit from the scale. After that, on the personal basis, again, having been around for a while, you know the people, you want to win or lose some battles, so you have the experience, which is good. It's part of the experience. And one thing which was very important that we promoted 4.5 years ago when we launched this new organization, we call it tech. Not only did we move Saint-Gobain, which was by product lines, in a complex matrix organization, like a lot of corporations. So you have, on any topic, you have 3-4 bosses. We said, no, one topic, one boss, a country CEO. We used to be in a matrix with horizontal functions, product lines, da-da-da. So it was slow, and it was not the right decision. It was a compromise on any topic with 4 or 5 people. We said, you are in charge as a CEO. And tech means trust, empowerment, collaboration. If you are the best Swiss manager within the group, you are in charge of Switzerland. We exchange of what it means to grow Saint-Gobain in Switzerland, and then I trust you. And when you think about that, the trust between teachers and students, parents and children, managers, is the most, for me, the most powerful element in life. Because my role, 3% is to define the strategy, but if it's the right one, it should go on for 30 years. My role is more a coach, captain of a team, and to make sure that you place and you select the best people in the best spot so that they develop 120% of their talents and not 60 or 70%. And trusting them is very important. Empowering them, so you change the rules. For instance, one basic element, we raise the threshold of CapEx. Decision used to be $3 million for Mark, now it's 10. Anything below, Mark decides as fast as he can. And then collaboration, because you have all the product lines of Saint-Gobain in your country. So don't take the excuse that they don't talk to each other in Paris and I cannot do it in China or in India. So tech for us is very important. And we have also 360 analysis, assessment of our managers and how tech they are. We even took, could surprise you, but we took a psychologist to come to the executive committee of Saint-Gobain 2 times to say, hey, what it means, trust each other. You are in a different economic environment. You are a new acquisition. I don't know you. How do we build trust? So for me, it's a very important, because management at the end of the day is taking care of the people. making sure that if you're an expert in violin, I don't ask you to play the saxophone, but someone could be very good at saxophone, and then the orchestra of Saint-Gobain will be better. So that's, and I spent more than half of my time just on people, HR, organization issues, which is, I think, the most rewarding task for any of us, is to make sure that you find the right students, you grow them. You know, I started 30 years ago as an intern, and someone was confident to grow me. And that's my task also, to grow the people, to reward them, to give them the right targets, priorities, to share the priorities, and to sometimes lose a battle, but learn from that. So it's what is fascinating in any, not only management, but any organization, is how you deal with the people and how you make sure you unleash the talents and you help the people to discover their own talents, sometimes they don't know, and helping each other. So that's a short answer, but it's a very rewarding and important topic.
Do you want to do one more question, and then we'll go to the reception.
Hi, I'm Apurva. I'm a first-year master's student here at Columbia. So my question is the company aiming at carbon neutral or carbon zero? Because considering the industry in which the company is operating, do you think carbon neutrality is a more practical goal than carbon zero? And also in the countries which we operate. So for example, like India, carbon zero is a very big term which we are using, considering the population and the production techniques which we use. So what do you think? Carbon neutral is a more practical goal than carbon zero for a global aspect, or carbon neutrality?
Today, our target is carbon neutrality. So far, we don't want to consider compensation, buying compensation for that, because we think there is so much to do on our processes, on our raw materials, on scope 3, that we put all the energy on that. We might see, by 2035, 2040, whether we need to do something, for example, carbon capture. We have not yet considered it seriously, because we think we can take away so much carbon in our products and processes. But at some point, we may fine-tune. But so far, I would say 100% of our effort is towards dropping, killing any carbon that we have. Carbon zero will be a bit more challenging at the end, so I don't know. But so far, we are on carbon neutrality. And we don't consider buying, 30% carbon reduction to buy a land or forest somewhere, etc. We just focus on what we need to do ourselves to drop our CO2 emissions.
Thank you.
So maybe one last word as conclusion. Again, thank you for all your questions. We can follow up during the cocktail. It's very important. I've been an engineer. We are open to all kinds of skills and abilities. And for me, you are the next generation, the young generation. I can tell you, manufacturing products, the atmosphere, the human dynamic in a plant, in an organization is fascinating. Interacting with researchers, with customers, seeing also the impact of what you built, being able to show to your families, to your children, this is the building we participated in, the building we renovated, the architects I interacted with. So for me, while we are in Saint-Gobain for so long, that we love to manufacture things, to invent new materials. And I think that's one area, if I compare sometimes with, consulting or finance, we are in real life. And we truly can make an impact to make the world a better home. So I urge you to put your brain, your power, your energy into action, particularly into manufacturing, because any of those challenges, you need innovation. And innovation will come from industry. It will not come from a trader with whatever financial mechanism. It will not come from, you have to act. You have to manufacture, you have to take your fingers, your arms, your brain, and to act and manufacture. So Saint-Gobain is one possibility. You have many and thousands of others, but I urge you to tackle those issues and the reality on the ground, because that's how we can drive a better future. So many thanks to all of you for that.
Really, I cannot think of any other leaders that should come to open our Tech CEO series. Thank you so much, particularly with the engineering background as an engineer internship before leading a global enterprise with so long history and touch on society, climate, sustainability, material, and the human dimension. And as you say, engineer has the best opportunity to really make a contribution for humanity. Our school vision, engineering for humanity, very much aligned with your vision, make the world a better home. Really, thank you. And so we have the reception in the Carlton Common, just one building next. And I hope the rent has stopped. And thank you for coming here. And please join us in the reception there. Thank you so much.